Today, I want to talk with you about four types of IV ketamine use. So just briefly to summarize, there's on-label, off-label, super off-label, and lastly, what label? So to explain this a bit further, on-label means that a drug is being used for a specific purpose. And in 1970, ketamine was approved by the FDA to be used as a medicine in general anesthesia for use in the operating room and the emergency room, specifically for painful procedures. So that is what it means if something is used on label, that it is FDA approved for a very specific purpose. So once that happened, ketamine 20 years later became a generic drug. Once a drug becomes FDA approved, it can be used for other purposes that are not on label. We call this off label. So right now, ketamine is being used off label for things such as depression, PTSD, anxiety, OCD, and some forms of chronic neuropathic pain. And that's mainly what we're using it for, using the latest evidence and the scientific studies to see what it can be effective for and what it won't be effective for. So that is an example of using it off-label. Now the third type would be super off-label. And what I mean by this is just a category that I made up myself. It means that there's not a lot of evidence or nearly no evidence for this in human studies. So an example of this would be amblyopia, right? There were some studies looking at rats where the ketamine seemed to help reduce amblyopia, which is a disorder where the eyes are slightly deviated. Now that hasn't been performed in human studies. So if someone were to use it in that type of setting, I would categorize that as super off-label. Another example would be tinnitus. And tinnitus is a chronic condition where someone hears kind of a ringing in their ears, and it's very annoying. There are some hypotheses that the tinnitus is caused by dysregulation of the NMDA receptor. Now, there is currently research going on, but no data has been published on this yet. So if someone were to use it for tinnitus, that would be an example of something I call super off-label. Now, finally, there's the fourth category. What label? And what I mean by this is there's minimal research or actually no research or scientific data in this realm, and it might just be purely anecdotal. So one example of this, if someone wants to be more creative or if someone wants to solve a problem, but let's say they're really healthy, but they just have some mental condition, let's just say they have a mental block about it, and they would be using ketamine for that purpose. And that is basically where there's no evidence necessarily to treat that. At our clinic, we really like to be evidence-based. So what that means is looking at the studies, reviewing the articles, seeing what it can and can't be effective for. So a lot of the times, if someone is coming for something in that super off-label category, you know, whether it's tinnitus or ADHD, I look at the data. And if the data doesn't really support that, or there's no data yet confirming that ketamine can be effective, I'm really not using it in those areas. You may be wondering, well, when is ketamine going to be FDA approved for depression or PTSD or anxiety? And as you may or may not know, the FDA approval process takes a long time, and it takes a lot of money to do those human studies to get the approval. So since ketamine is a generic drug, it's already been FDA approved, no large pharmaceutical company has the incentive to take a generic drug and to do research. Now, on the other hand, a pharmaceutical company can take a derivative of ketamine, for example, esketamine, and then run the studies. Once they take a derivative and create a novel compound, then they can now market it and price it at a higher rate for the patients. And this is the example of Spravato, also known as esketamine. It was produced by Johnson & Johnson, where they took a derivative of generic ketamine to see if it could be effective in treating treatment-resistant depression. And they did get FDA approval recently, a few years ago, for the treatment of depression. Now, will generic ketamine be FDA approved for these various purposes? It's hard to say, again, because of the cost, the time factor, but what's great about it is once a drug becomes FDA approved, then it can be used by physicians for different purposes that are not necessarily on label, which is the reason why you're probably seeing more information about ketamine. There's more ketamine clinics that are opening up because as licensed providers. We now have the ability to use these medications for a different purpose. So again, to summarize, there's four categories: on-label, off-label, super off-label, and finally, what label? And that's just kind of a brief summary of how I think about the categories in the ways that ketamine is being used today. Please let me know what you think about this. Hit that like and subscribe button so that I can know which information is most useful for you. And I will see you in the next video.